let's do it this way. When you're a beginner, so let's call it level one, as, mm-hmm. as you suggested, then I would say that you should have a strong foundation in understanding some sort of engineering. That would be a very good benefit. Like if you studied political science and your major is in like biology and you took archery at university, it would be pretty damn difficult to start an FEA career. Like you don't have the fundamentals. And like, sure you can, but like, you know, it would take so much effort that it will be difficult. So at the very minimum, having this knowledge is great. And of course, as you progress in FEA and you solve more and more complex problems, your engineering knowledge and understanding will grow as well. So you don't have to be an expert in your field by any stretch of imagination, but having a strong base completely outside of FEA, like even before you launch any software whatsoever, if you can solve something by hand and you kind of understand the very basics of it, FEA is a great tool for you to deepen the knowledge in FEA and by doing so, deepen the knowledge in engineering. So that's wonderful. And it would be nice to, you know, be able to make a geometry in FEA, like the very basic CAD operations, like, you know, the basic stuff. And then meshing it, nothing. Like, I know that people start teaching FEA with like shape functions of elements. Like I finished my PhD thesis not even knowing that there are shapes. So you'll be fine without that at the start. As long as you know how to mesh your model and you Googled like 20 nice mesh models on Google mm-hmm. images and you simply see, okay, this is how it's supposed to look like more or less, you're fine. Like that's my level when I was doing a PhD. So that's enough. And that would be level one. Of course, knowing also that, okay, I can have a von Mises stress and sometimes it can be higher than yield and it doesn't mean that everybody will die, is a super stress reliever. Because I would say that on level one, when your boss or your customer, depending on your situation, ask you to deliver something, right? And you do an analysis and you get 400 megapascals of stress beyond yield. Like the instant thought is it will fail. And then your customer tells you something like, dude, like we're using this for 20 years. And you're like, well, that's bad. So it's good to know that it's more than that, like having this comprehension that things are more complex that you would think. Like I think that would be the best asset. Then on level two, you kind of start to understand more and you realize that linear analysis may not be the best approach, that there are nonlinear solutions and those make things easier. Sure, at some level you need to grab hold of an FEA software that actually allows you to do stuff in nonlinear realm relatively accurately. And while there are open source solutions for that nowadays, it's also a costly thing. So it's kind of hard to start there purely from financial reasons. So, and that's definitely an issue. But when you grab hold of any software that actually can do nonlinear, playing around, doing stuff, checking what works, what doesn't, I would say that that would put you in the second category. So you're kind of like, even though in design you still may use nonlinear analysis, but sometimes from time to time you use nonlinear solutions as well, at least you're aware of it, kind of like you understand what it means. And that would be a nice move. And then, like, you know, in time, you become good at what you become good at. And let's call it level three, sure. And then you become an expert. But then I think that with becoming an expert, you also suddenly realize that you're not an expert in anything else. By this, I mean, when I was on level one and two, I did designs that I would never do today because I would be too afraid. Like I know now some things about few things, which also means that I know that I don't know as much about anything else, which makes it stressful mm-hmm. to some degree to say, okay, so let's do something else, right? So it kind of focuses you a lot. And sure, world need a lot of focused specialists because like, think about it this way, if you would have to buy a dog house for your puppy, like you wouldn't go to a normal carpenter, you would rather go to a carpenter who specializes in building dog houses because he's the best dude, like he's the one, right? And it's your puppy, so you want the best thing, right? And then someone can say, well, but he's losing a lot of market because he's not building tables, he's not doing furniture and stuff. Yeah, but on the same time, he's the best in what he does, right? So while you narrow what you want to accomplish in some sense, you also you can go deep. But with FEA, the cool thing is that you can switch industries. So if you're like a specialist in some sort of analysis, it doesn't mean that you will do dog houses, because in some sense in FEA relation, that would mean that you know how to cut a hole that is circular in few boards, and you can apply the same skill somewhere else. Mm-hmm. So with FEA, it's the same. Like, you have a big freedom of choice, which is great, because not only you can specialize in something, you can use this specialty in different areas of life, in different areas of engineering, perhaps. And that's a huge advantage. Mm-hmm. So that when you're at the point that you can switch industries and do whatever you like, in some sense, I would say that that's when you start to, you know, become an expert or specialist in it. Mm-hmm.